worry about the boys. She's not saying because you don't worry about girls too. Of course not. But the point is this, that there's much greater awareness on the community of sexual abuse of girls. If the 35-year-old pastor who was a single man took an interest in your 15-year-old daughter, wanted to go off on dates with her, you might be a bit concerned, eh? Much as you might like the pastor and all that sort of stuff. But if a 35-year-old pastor wanted to take your 15-year-old son out, your 15-year-old son was a bit of a troubled youth and you were keen for him to have a mentor, he might think nothing of it. Probably wouldn't think anything of it. In fact, you'd be delighted that somebody was showing interest in your teenage son. And that is why I think in churches, boys in particular are so much more at risk. The findings from the Anglican Church study were dramatic and completely surprised us. We found that 3/4 of all the complainants were men. 3/4. This was 191 cases across the country that we examined, 180 complainants, 135 individuals, which is at the bottom of the screen there. 3/4 of the complainants were boys. The Catholic Church, very similar, there's been a massive study done in the United States, which found sort of 75 to 80% also were boys. And pretty much all the studies of abuse in the Catholic Church give you that sort of statistic, and boys between about 12 and 15 years old being the major victims. Now, there's been a lot of discussion, as you can imagine, in the Catholic Church about celibacy, and is that the reason or linked to the abuse of boys? And I certainly thought that until this study, because what we find in a church which doesn't have celibacy as a requirement, exactly the same patterns. And that suggests to me very strongly that this is about opportunity, not about motivation. Okay? Go back to Finkelhor's 4 preconditions. The person who's been motivated to sexually abuse a child, there's been a lot of discussion about maybe because of the requirement of celibacy, that it arrests psychosexual development in teenage boys who are motivated to go on to the priesthood or become brothers, and somehow that distorts their sexuality, and that's what motivates them to abuse boys. Or possibly that what I think the Anglican Church study suggests is that it's number 3, the external barriers must be overcome to get access to a child, and that's much easier in churches, whether it's the Catholic Church, the Anglican Church, the Baptist Church, the SDA, whatever. Much easier with boys than with girls. I mean, in the Anglican Church, the Catholic Church, more than the Catholic traditions and Catholic traditions, you have altar boys. You also have altar girls, but again, I think parents are just a bit more protective about girls and find it more unusual to have older male relationships with teenage girls, but with teenage boys, it's part of the rite of passage, it's part of the good thing about the village raising the teenage male child. Boys are particularly vulnerable, it appears, in our churches, and we need to be aware of that, and also that boys are much less likely to speak up. The average length of time before the men in our Anglican Church study disclosed was 25 years. 25 years. For many of the women, that was true too. They took 20 years, but many of the girls reported it immediately or within the first few months after it happened. So you got quite a lot of disclosure by the girls early on. Remember, there weren't all that many of them. But with the boys, there was almost no disclosure early on, pretty much none. And the average was 25 years. And this is true of a lot of other research. I remember very well talking when I was writing the book to a woman who had been abused by her great uncle, and all the siblings, 4 children, 3 girls and 1 boy, had all been abused by this man. They didn't know that when they were kids. The first one disclosed when she was in her late 20s. The second girl in her early 30s, the third girl in her late 30s, finally admitted to each other they had been abused. And the man? 62. And he said, and never talked to me about it again. For 30 years after his sisters had disclosed the secret, this man could not bring himself even to talk about it. And so boys were only at risk because we accept one-on-one relationships much more easily. They're also more at risk because they won't tell us. The third reason they're more at risk, and I know this is scary, but when you do get male target pedophiles, that is, pedophiles who target boys, and typically they target boys of a certain age, like 9 to 12, or 11 to 4, or 14, they typically have a particular age range they're attracted to. When they do target boys, the numbers of victims are absolutely massive. In a very famous study done in the United States by a man called Abel and his colleagues, he managed to get permission from the US government and through various means to talk to sex offenders who had not been imprisoned, who'd gone for treatment programs, and to get them to freely talk about their abusive patterns on the basis that they would not be charged, that they would not subpoena the records. The records were actually kept in another country just to ensure. And it's a very famous study done in 1987. And what they found was that on average, the men who targeted girls had 20 victims, which is horrifying. But the men who targeted boys, the average was 150. And you see this, don't you, when you read news reports about boys' schools and all sorts of things. Often when a victim comes forward, it's just the tip of the iceberg of the history of abuse that has gone on. If I hear about a boy being sexually abused, well, frankly, whether it's a boy or a girl, I'm always thinking there's more. I would rather think that a leader that way than assume otherwise, quite frankly, but particularly with sexual abuse of boys.